Okay, good evening, everyone, or good morning, depending on where you are. It's a great pleasure for me to give this lecture. Actually, the most surgery I love it is the fundal application. So it's my talk. Okay, what I need from all of you, because I know most of you may be far better than me, but I need you to understand more than to know the information, because it's a lot of controversies in this topic. So simply, what is gastroesophageal reflux? Okay. Is there's only reflux and the reflux or Jarrett reflux disease. Okay, it's very common in infant and children, which is 2/3 of them will be disappear spontaneously by the age of 2. Some definition, reflux itself or gastroesophageal reflux is the basis of the gastric content into esophagus with or without regurgitation or vomiting. Jarrett, that means gastroesophageal reflux disease, lead to troublesome symptoms that affect the daily functioning or complication. Refractory Jarrett is this not responding to optimal treatment after 6 weeks of management. Optimal therapy is the maximum you will do, either medical or non-medical, to stop this reflux to avoid its complication and depending on your local facilities. It may differ from one center to one center, differ from one country to one country, it depends on what you have. Second point, some infant with these children, they will have the pathology one or the reflux disease or Jarrett, okay, which is either failure to grow, it's a failure to thrive, respiratory complication, like most dangerous, it's called apneic spell. Apneic spell, that means simply is the patient will have cyanosis after feed, called apneic spell. Usually happen in newborn. So these kids, you cannot send them home without fixation. Usually they will end up by surgery. Okay, and this population will require either medical or surgical. This area is a lot of medical, is a lot of anatomy and physiology to understand what is gastroesophageal reflux. Physiology. First, the lower esophageal sphincter is not anatomical sphincter. It's a functional sphincter. Okay, it's made by inner circular muscle, which needs an oblique muscle, but it's this inner circular muscle make a high pressure zone. But actually, there is no anatomical sphincter. Okay, the phrenoesophageal ligament, or actually membrane which is make a part of this. Okay, there's a difference between the pressure in the abdomen and the negative pressure in the chest, which make it much a sort of valve to close from the abdominal side. And location of the sphincter below the diaphragm. Okay, angle of face has to be acute, which we'll discuss this point regarding the gastrostomy. Any increase interabdominal pressure, like for example, after a reduction of congenital diaphragmatic hernia, of oxonflux, of gastroschisis, some of these kids, they develop reflux. And neurological patient, especially cerebral palsy, whatever the cause ended by cerebral palsy, with or without scoliosis, which affects your plan of managing, especially surgical aspects. Physiology, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our God, give us some protective measurement or some protective factors. Number is called esophageal clearance. What does it mean, clearance? If you have the food from your mouth to the stomach, it has to be cleared completely from the esophagus. No more food inside the esophagus. It's affected by motility, which is primary, second, tertiary. The most important is the primary one. The tertiary is not affected. The second is more or less medium, but the most important is the primary. You have to understand something is this swallowing mechanism, okay? You will start by your mouth. So when you put the food in your mouth, this is a voluntary act. Once it reaches to the fangs, it's not more involuntary, it's involuntary. So the peristalsis starts from your fangs down to the stomach. This is the primary one. So initiated by once the food reaches the fangs. Okay, your saliva pH is alkaline, so it will affect if there's any mild reflux, it's supposed to neutralize the pH in the lower esophagus. And the gravity. Okay, gravity is a weak part because theoretically, if you have a good esophageal physiological valve, you will not have reflux, even during sleep. Okay, the reflux is not only acidic, it can be the gastric content, much worse can be the bile content. Okay. Although the saliva is alkaline, but the esophagus cannot tolerate bile, cannot tolerate pepsin, trypsin, and cannot tolerate bile salt. So if you do scope in the upper esophagus and you find bile is one of the surgical indications for fun to protect your esophagus. As this clinical manifestation, the most important is the gash or vomiting, pulmonary symptoms. Dysphagia is usually associated with obstruction, either stricture or achalasia, for example. Pain, usually the pain comes with older kids. There's no baby who say, I have a chest pain. No, usually the kids will have a pain. Hemorrhage, as hematemesis or occult blood in the stool. If you go, more details, okay, the most important point the mother will say to you, my baby is not himself. My baby is not taking his normal feed. He doesn't like his butt. This is the simple word the mother would say to you. He's irritable. He's not himself. He's taking a bottle. Even putting the bottle in his mouth, he's just refusing. He's turning his face to other side. Okay. The position of the neck with hyperextension of the neck. Okay. This is very simple heard by the mother. Okay. Regarding gastrointestinal symptoms, vomiting. Okay. Regurg, heart pain, and chest pain combination, usually all the child explaining very well. Maybe gastric pain, hematemesis. Again, we said dysphagia, it will happen only when you have a sort of obstruction, like stricture. Okay, stricture can happen because of the post-op patient, caustic material. It's usually both associated with reflux, so one makes the other worse. The airway, you just discover some people with the treatment for years as asthma, and they only have reflux. So to have wheezes, stridors, cough, or hoarseness. If you examine the patient, you have dental erosion, you have anemia unexplained, okay, you have to think for a flux. Osteitis, which is diagnosed usually by biopsy, scope and biopsy, stricture, and the late sign, the late sequelae is the paratosophy. I said airways, apneic spell. Apneic spell is classic. The baby after feet, even after you make the baby after eructation, the baby will have cyanotic apneic spell, which is affecting his life. Again, can be treated for years with asthma, and he's not asthmatic. The asthma is just a very simple to explain by the very small amount of acid reflux going to his bronchi. It makes severe spasm to present it to the medical side as asthma. And you will hear wheezes, clear wheezes. But actually, this is because of the small amount of acid reflux in the bronchi. If the reflux is more severe, the aspiration pneumonia will start and repeat. The keratotitis media also can affect this baby. It's called red flags. Red flags, that means the baby, you think for another differential, you have to think about it. Weight loss, lethargy. Usually surgery, the baby as a lethargy, the mother say he's not himself. Fever, excessive irritability, pain. A lot of factors you have to go through this one. Okay, what is predisposing condition for the reflux? Okay. There is general ones called like increased intra-abdominal pressure, ascites, obesity, peritoneal dialysis, ventricular peritoneal shunt, anatomically related to us as a pediatric diaphragmatic hernia or omphalocele and gastroschisis. I put the diaphragmatic hernia, omphalocele and gastroschisis with two factors. They are more liable to reflux, and all of them, they have a sort of non-rotation of the bowel. Because the bowel all the time is not in, never came back to the abdomen in a normal arrangement, which is discussed before for the malrotation session. Short esophagus. Short esophagus can happen from tracheostomy fistula lung gap, can happen with repeated reflux because the fibrosis makes the esophagus more shorter, or the caustic material. If the child has drink a caustic material, he will develop again a short esophagus by contraction, by fibrosis. Hiatal hernia, either sliding one or classic hiatal hernia full, or thoracic stomach, the thoracic gastric volvulus, all this is sort of different form of hiatal hernia, which will need a fund duplication. Hiatal hernia, if the patient is normally, brain normally, he will never need gastrostomy. Neurological patient, all causes ended cerebral palsy, like asphyxia, meningitis, anything. Intracranial hemorrhage for extreme premature, all this with ended by is called cerebral palsy. Cerebral palsy is a big entity, so on neurological patient will be a little bit more surgical aggressive with the treatment to fix his reflux, because this group is more liable to complication. One of the end stage or chronic reflux ended by Barrett. Barrett is simply the esophagus lining is called squamous epithelium. Squamous epithelium is a sort of like a skinny epithelium without hair follicle. So it's a squamous epithelium. If the squamous epithelium transform to columnar epithelium, is called Barrett's esophagus. So the Barrett's esophagus, if it develop cancer, it will not squamous carcinoma. Squamous carcinoma, it will be adenocarcinoma coming from the columnar epithelium, which happened by the metaplasia. This is what's called Barrett's esophagus. Okay, go to diagnosis. Upper GI study. What it does mean by upper GI study? If I'm doing upper GI, what it does mean? Okay, before going to reflux, that means I need to study esophagus, to study stomach, up to the DJ. So when I'm doing this study, it's two types of study. If the baby without nasogastric or the baby with nasogastric. If the baby without nasogastric, That means I'm giving him a bottle of contrast. What we are using is contrast. There are three types of contrast. There's barium contrast, which is a new barium, which is very liquid, very nice. Okay, and there's gastrographin, and the third one is omnibic or non-ionic contrast. Gastrographin hydroscopic is ionic one. So nobody will use gastrographin to study reflux because if the patient aspirated, you will have a sort of chemical pneumonia. So please don't use gastrographin. You can use a new form of barium, which is not very liquid, not watery. It's liquid, but not watery. Or you can use omnibic, which is very safe. When I'm doing a swallow, I have to study from the mouth is using a bottle. If he's not cerebral palsy or have a normal gag reflex. So you have, you follow the contrast from the mouth of the baby down to the stomach. What I will see esophageal peristalsis. I will see also that what's called esophageal clearance. If the contrast is going straight to the stomach, not taking time in the esophagus, that means he has a good clearance or good peristalsis, a sort of, okay? Then I will see where is the position of the cardia, is above or below the diaphragm. This is Abujar studies more for anatomy, nothing else. Okay. Then you will never comment on the reflux with small amount of contrast. You have to feel the stomach. If the flux happened early with a small amount of contrast in the stomach, that means he's early significant reflux. Okay. But by the end of the day, if the study is negative, it means nothing. Okay. Because negative upper GI study, it doesn't mean the patient does not have reflux. Okay, the other point I have said, so I will see gastric esophageal motility, esophageal clearance, position of the card of the gastroesophageal junction. I have to test to see gastric emptying. Last point, I have to see it in the world of upper GI study, is the position of the DJ, duodenojejunal junction, which is the left of the aorta, the level of L1, L2, or left of the aorta above the level of the bilateral if the baby has a contrast, which is what. This is a study of a malrotation. What I'm giving you this why, because if you see this study, there is a sort of duodenal obstruction. So the patient has this reflux, is a relieving valve. So don't say this refluxing patient. But again, it's a newborn first day. So you have the cardia is white. And this is okay for his age. Okay, but don't comment is a patient with a sort of duodenal or gastric obstruction on the reflux. It would be a false comment. Okay, the other one, this is cerebral palsy patients that mean you have a nasogastric in the throat. Nasogastric by itself, it induces reflux because it keeps the gastroesophageal junction patent by the tube. If you want to do a proper one, do it by the smallest tube you can, not by the largest tube you can. Because as much as you will make the junction wide by the tube, big tube, he will have reflux even if he has. Okay, so early reflux with the empty stomach, early reflux to the esophagus. You have to understand, for the baby taken by bottle, you have to differentiate between the feeling and the fluxing stage. Feeling stage is the baby taking the bottle. So this study, I prefer for myself, I'm attending all the study to take decision because it's a dynamic study. Or you have a pediatric radiologist in your department, you can trust him. So if your baby using bottle, you have to differentiate between the feeling stage and the fluxing stage after filling the stomach. In the nasogastric tube, you use the smallest one. And once you see the contrast in the stomach, this is the early reflux because the stomach is still empty. And it's still reflux. You see, even after filling, this reflux. Okay, and this is reflux up to his throat, which is called severe reflux. Okay. By the way, he has a very good gastric emptying even before filling the rest of the stomach. Okay. Sometimes you will have a patient coming to you with gastrostomy alone. Let's speak about this point about anatomy of the gastrostomy. Okay, your stomach or our stomach is a posterior organ. Okay. When you do gastrostomy, you will take in the anterior wall of the stomach, which is more or less posterior, to be attached to the anterior abdominal. So you are disturbing the anatomy of the cardia. First, you are losing the acute angle of Hess. So this patient, if you do open gastrostomy, is up to 50 to 60%. If they don't have reflux, they will have it, okay? So we don't like to do gastrostomy alone in a neurological patient. So all neurological patients need gastrostomy, go for fun, okay? The next one is the laparoscopy. Scopic one because it's less, but it's still up to 40%. The least one to induce reflux for gastrostomy is the BEG, is percutaneous endoscopic gastrostomy, because you will inflate the stomach and by the air, the nearest point to the abdominal wall, you put the gastrostomy in it. Either lab assisted or not, this is the least one to in, to reduce or to for the patient to develop reflux because of the gastrostomy itself. So if the patient came to you with a gastrostomy for study and he has a reflux, if you see this is a feeling stage, is a reflux, but also has a very good gastric emptying, and this one reflux, even after all the contrast went down in the stomach, he didn't clear his upper esophagus. So his clearance of esophagus is not good. When you do surgery for a patient with gastrostomy, if the gastrostomy is not your way, don't take it down. Okay, we'll go for open and lab later. But if it's in your way, take it down. Close the gastric fistula, do your fundoplication, and do the gastrostomy at the end again. Okay, there is a couple of things called BH and called multi-channel interluminal embolism. We'll go for this in the next slide. Embolism. This is the BH alone is just to measure the BH of the lower esophagus. You put it, depend on the age of the baby, 1.5 centimeter, 2 centimeter above the cardia, and you confirm the position of the tip of the catheter by X-ray. The sensor only at the lower end of this. What's the indication of pH? Is 24-hour probe. The patient can be sleeping, up, jumping, playing. Usually doing with the respiratory symptoms, especially apneic spelling newborn, irritable and intractable crying, anorexia. This is all indication, but is not, is the pH alone is not specific and no evidence based for it. The multi-channel is just, if you say, it's not only the sensor down, it's a sensor all in all esophagus. So he can see the first, very sensitive to the pH of the exam 4, also can differentiate between acidic and alkali in the lower esophagus. It give you accurate pH. Also, you can see which level of the reflux it will reach because the sensor is all around, all in all area. Or differentiate between what's called non-erosive reflux. He would go esophagoscope and the patient looks like a normal reflux, but he's normal esophageal mucosa because non-erosive reflux, but he has a reflux. Okay, and called hypertensive esophagus, has a high pressure in the esophagus itself. Okay, also we can use for evaluation of your medical treatment for proton bump as a follow-up. And also again, differentiate between acidic and alkaline. So it's different between the normal BH. The BH is one sensor and the MII is a sensor all over the esophagus from up to down. Okay, conservative study generally is not useful or necessary for infant with uncomplicated regurgitation. Means nothing because maybe just a regurg. So vaginitis already diagnosed by endoscopy, you will not need it. Okay, or dysphagia or heartbreak. Because dysphagia usually associated with obstruction, a sort of. Okay, the accuracy examination depends on a couple of factors. You have to stop the medication 7 days for a proton pump. For H2 blocker, we have to stop it 2 days. Okay, reflux episodes continue to have occurs if the BH less than 4. Okay, BH is continuous monitoring. As I said, the patient will have the probe. We have a normal life. He can eat anything. He can play. He can jump. So we have to do the BH in all position with his own all normal life. Okay, and percentage of total time the BH was less than 4. This is the one accounted as a reflux. Other than an endoscopic with biopsy. So we discussed about the upper GI. We discussed about the BH monitoring, go for the scope. The scope is a very good tool in diagnosis, but still you can go take patient to do fundus without scope. We'll discuss it in a recent, you know, guideline defined reflux, which emphasizes the presence of endoscopically visible breaks. This is different from the non-erosive esophagitis, which you can diagnose only by the MII. Okay, if breaks in the esophageal mucosa, sometimes you can see the area of Barrett, which is columnar metaplasia. Okay, usually it's to start by the area above the gastroesophageal reflux, but again, middle esophageal can be again by reflux. Indication, you do it in any infant or child failed medical therapy as a workup of the patient with red flux. You don't know what the diagnosis, you are struggling, you have those two. And any patient with Barrett, you will do a scope and also go what's called surveillance. You have to do scope every 6 months or every 1 year. It depends on the condition of the child. It's called nuclear scintigraphy. It's nuclear medicine. It's called in different way milk scan. Okay, you give the baby a bottle or if it's older, a meal with nuclear medicine in it. So it is evaluated only as a post-prandial. You give give them meals and you will take the study post-prandial. It's a very good in especially pneumonia. If you find this milk or this radioactive material in the lung, that means patient has aspiration. Okay, it's not recommended in routine diagnosis. Usually, I don't think it's done too much, but still we can do it to confirm aspiration. Medical management is a little bit senior people or the middle-aged people, you know, there's a lot of air about cisperide, which is prokinetic. They saw this helping closing the gastroesophageal junction, but it's not pro-evidence. There's no evidence base for it. And proton bump is much more effective than H2 blocker, but any antacid, either proton bump or H2 blocker, is not effective as biliary reflux because it's a different mechanism. There is no evidence for proton bump inhibitor in newborn, but again, is overused. And there's a lovely thing is called food sickener. It's very good in the babies. It's helping the baby to sicken the food. If you sicken the food, the baby will not vomit. Especially if the baby will not to start, you will know that by time he will grow up of this problem and he will be a normal child. So food sickener or to make the food sicken is a different cereal. There's a lot of things. There's a special form of reflux. You can put a cereal on the normal feet. A lot of things, but it initially helps especially in newborn and not in older kids. When I will go for fundo as initial management, when I'll take my patient, I'll say, no, I will not go for medical treatment, I'll go for fundo. There's a social part and there's a medical part. The medical part, if a baby in ICU with respiratory distress requiring gastrostomy, again, I said gastrostomy itself it makes reflux. So, and he's respiratory distress, he'll go for fundo and the gastrostomy. All neurological patient needs gastrostomy, you cannot do gastrostomy, you have to do gastrostomy in fundo. This is not a point of this. Okay, baby with apneic spell, you cannot leave him, you can't send him, it's a crime. So you have to fix him before sending him home. And back, it makes reflux, could make the esophagus more shorter, it makes reflux, and the flux makes the structure worse. It's just a couple of sessions, then you do fundo. Okay? And the baby with hiatal hernia, so it's anatomically need to be fixed. Okay, there's another social problem. For example, I know there's different people from all over the world, but if you have patient with family is not compliant, you are not understanding the problem. And the patient, for example, the nearest hospital between this baby and between the patient and you, or the patient living far, about 400 kilometers far from you, and you need gastrostomy, and the refluxing is severe, just do fundoplication with or without gastrostomy, depending on the indication. So decision, it has to be social. Medical is the most important, but you have to consider some social element. Okay, now to go for a surgical management. Open versus lap. For me, as an old generation surgeon, if I'm teaching my team, I will not teach him to do lap if he doesn't know how to do open, because it's a principle, okay? But in general, newborn and the infant, I would say first year or small, less than, say 4 to 5 kilo, maximum 8 kilo, still you can be easy open, okay? Bigger children, if you are using laparoscopy, it's just a nightmare to do it open, especially with scoliosis, because simply the vision is different. You have to go in. For laparoscopy, the camera is going too much in, so you can see everything clear. In open, actually, is a nightmare. Depends. So if I'm teaching somebody is the classic. So if I'm doing open, I'm doing only in newborn. For me, I'll do midline incision just to keep the gastrostomy away from the incision. Some people do it transverse. It makes no difference, but you have to know what you're doing. I think midline incision is much more safer to keep the gastrostomy away from your wound. But the standard for fundo is laparoscopy. Okay, a kind of problem with the stricture with Jared, which one you'll go for fundo first to prevent the worsening of the stricture, or you go for a stricture dilatation first. Better to go for dilatation sequence every 2 weeks or every 3 weeks under anesthesia until you have a good caliber, then do fundo. Because it's not nice to go for dilatation after fundo may disrupt your rehab in early post-op. Okay, just some points, and we'll go for video in detail about what it is. Okay, when you go for fundo blockage, certain point you have to consider. First, you have to repair the crura. Please, the esophagus pass through the right crura. There is nothing needed to do the left crura. So the both limb, our esophagus pass through both limb is the right crura, no left crura. And you will repair it still to the esophagus if it is white. And you have to repair it. We'll discuss in detail why. Okay, we are using either 2-0 silk or AC1. Simply non-absorbent material. Some people are using proline, but proline have a good memory, number one, so the stitch may fall off, may open, or it's just pointing in. So yeah, I prefer, or all other, we see that, or silk or isbon. I would say 2-0 in all kids, but in newborn, I may use 3-0. Okay. The retropharyngeal window has to be wide enough to make a loose wrap above the left gastric artery, which we'll go in the video in a very in detail in this one. Before the fixing, 4 stitches on both sides of the esophagus to fix the esophagus to the diaphragm. There's no benefits, evidence, there's no evidence based about it. Okay. A wrap fixation usually is 3 stitches. Okay. The distance between one is 1 centimeter to 1.5 to 1 centimeter, depending on the age, but the length of the wrap all between 2 to 3 centimeters. Okay, again, it's different the age. You will do that newborn 2 centimeter and 3 stitch length of all the wrap is 2 centimeter loose wrap. You do the bigger case 3 centimeter. Okay, no dissection of the anterior esophagus. Okay, and don't look for vagus. If you look for vagus, you will injure it. So just keep it. So vagus is very attached to esophagus. If you're a good plane, you will not see it. You will not touch it. When you do the wrap, you have to have a pass either big oral nasogastric or bougie, so you will not make a tight, you will not close the esophagus. Again, depending on the patient weight, this is the weight, the skid is the table for the weight. You can know by the weight, you can, every case, you will forget it, so just before the surgery, just know what you will do. For lab fondue, it depends on the French or frog position to stand. To be, it depends on the age, either the child is bigger enough, you can stand between his legs. Or if a small baby, you can take him to the end of the table. For me, I'm usually standing on the right side of the patient, like I'm doing. I'm not putting this. You will have very difficult to put the patient in frog leg, especially cerebral palsy with the spastic limbs. It's just very difficult. So I'm using for this. It doesn't mean anything. Whatever the position make you happy, do it. Okay. A liver tract, you can use the proper liver. There's a liver tract attached to the table with nothing. Or I prefer to use Alice, which I'll go in detail in a minute, just under the left lobe of the liver, and I will catch the diaphragm, and this is my liver tract. Okay, a board position is different. We'll go different with the size of the patient, with the age of the patient. Because if the small baby, you have to go down. This is anatomy, this is more or less, this is adult diaphragm, but usually you're putting the camera in the umbilicus. So if the baby is small, you will put the working board down. You have a space or a length to work. If the baby is older, older baby usually will go up. This is how to do gastrostomy. You have to mark usually you are marking the gastrostomy before going in, but you have to consider a couple of points, guys. First, you have to mark the costal margin in both sides, okay, and you have to mark the midline. Usually, this is a gastrostomy is about 2 fingers or 1.5 inch away from the costal margin, because you don't like to have by the groin this gastrostomy going under costal margin. It's very painful. Sometimes touches the wound, and I saw case with osteomyelitis of the ribs because of the bad position gastrostomy. Sometimes you have to take it down and put it again, so just do it accurate from the start. If from inside you cannot fix the stomach to this direction, you will not go lateral because you will hit the costal margin. You will go medial and up. It depends on the size of the stomach, especially with the patient with scoliosis, which I will go in detail with it. So the gastrostomy has to be 2 finger or 1.5 inch finger, boy's finger, not my finger, okay? So you will under the costal margin. If the stomach is small, you cannot reach this, you will go up parallel to the costal margin, parallel and medial, okay? This is the position of the port. You have a lot of position. Okay, as I said, this is a camera, okay? So this is the way you go. Sometimes you have to put the port lower down. If you are using, guys, adult instrument, which you can actually, and most of my work is done by more or less adult instrument, 5 millimeter, okay, you can go just, it's easy, but you can go by the board lower down so to make it easy. And use a short talker, don't you? You never use the long talker. For me, I'm using cells, so I'm not going for cells in detail. Okay, you know, another problem is the scoliosis. As a scoliosis to the left or to the right. Scoliosis makes it's a difficult scoliosis, especially the severe one, B, is the stomach will go very high up. You will not see it will be pulled up because of the position. In this case, the gastrostomy will be very difficult. So it is because the stomach all under the inside the chest, in the thoracic cage or under the ribs. So usually the gastrostomy will be going parallel to 1 inch parallel to the costum, and usually it ends by this position. So we have the gastro, the stomach. I know you have to mark the gastrum before start, before insufflation, but actually you will not board the board for the gastrostomy, except when you camera in, because sometimes the stomach is active. This is why when you're doing upper GI contrast, you have to know the anatomy and where is the stomach relation to the costal marge. You have to know everything before going into surgery. And you will not put a board just because you're marking board from outside. With the camera board, you could put the left working channel board and liver tract. But the other two boards, you would put it after measuring where is the stomach and it can reach to normally to the gastrostomy side. Put it in your mind that you are doing fundal location using the size of the stomach. So you have to keep in mind that if you measure the stomach before fundo, it's not the same measurement after fundo, because it makes the fundo make a little bit stomach smaller. Okay, this is all points. So the board, you put one umbilicus, you will put the, this two is a working board, but you will do this first. This is a liver retractor. Okay, for this one, I will not put it, especially in viscoelosis patient, except if this stomach where it will reach as a size. Okay, I will go. This is a video without any montage. Okay, and it's done by one of my trainees. So we see step by step what we can, and I will run the area we not need. Okay, this will take the stomach. Usually you will take the stomach laterally. Okay, the people said you can start by the left side of the stomach, but I prefer to make the window laterally. Okay, medial. This is medial. This is a peritoneal. If you have to open this peritoneum to see what's behind. Okay, this is a good size of stomach, so it will make your life easy. And this is a convention, is not a set. If you can see this type of port from the side, is a conventional one. Okay, now I will go back. Okay, this is, you will go here, okay, and you make the window. After making the window, you have to be sure that you will do the wrap above the left gastric, not the short gastric. So this is the window. Once you will feel the stomach, you will never touch the anterior esophageal wall. You'll go behind the esophagus and make the window. And this is the crura. Okay, you can use the suction to make your field clear. And just by peanuts, you will open the window. You make it wide until you reach the other side of the abdomen, which is, you will see here the abdominal wall. Then you see you are opening the window very clear until you will have a clear window from both sides. Very easy. And the camera can go in very easy if you know where you are. Do not go upside down because you can open the pleura. You have to go just later. Don't go up. You have to know your direction when you're doing this window. Until you reach, you will see clear view from the other side. You see? Keep going. This video is out any montage done by one of my trainees. So it's a very clear after that. Then after you find that our window is below the artery, which you'll see it very soon. This is a window we are doing. Okay, then we discover that our window is below the artery, not above it. So it's just very simple. You will take the artery down in a very simple way. And do never look for the vagus. You will not see it. It's just attached to the esophagus. Okay, this is the way. You see, camera can go in until you have a proper window. You see, this is the artery. So we make the window in a wrong position. No problem. Correct yourself and then take this artery down. So do not do the fundo above the artery. See, this is a pulsating artery here. You see, this is a pulsating artery. So we'll take it down. So we'll be sure that our rep is above the artery. So if you miss the place, if you miss the window, just correct yourself and take, you see, this is the artery and the vein, take it down. So we'll change our window to this area. You can finish it until you see the clear area, then you take the artery down. Both are right. You can see here the artery very clear. Okay, you see, we didn't reach the other side, but we will correct. This is a complete video without any montage. Let us go. Okay, cut this part. Again, this is the artery. It is the left gastric. So you have to take it up because the fundo has to be, the wrap has to be in this area. So now I will get this one back. You see this one? So we'll take this one and we'll make our window for the wrap above the artery. Is that clear? So this is the left gastric and you have to go above the artery, then finish your window clear. Okay, there's no point in that you may miss the place, but and this is the two limb of the right crura of the diaphragm. There are two limbs for the right crura. There's no left crura for the esophagus. Okay, esophagus passing only through the right crura. This is a proper window, and the artery now is below the fundus, below the rib, will be below the rib. Okay, you see here, you will see the abdominal wall of the other side. You see, this is the abdominal wall of the, so your window is complete, or the baby window is complete. I'll go back for this one. Okay, this is the window. Then we pass an instrument to get what's called umbilical tape around the lower esophagus. Okay, this is umbilical tape. Okay, this Maryland is behind the esophagus, and it will take the umbilical tape behind the esophagus. Once you have the tape around the esophagus, I would say 80% of the surgery is done, because you have the window and you have the umbilical tape around it. And this is you will hold it, and this all the traction will be done by the extreme left side an instrument or port. Then you will take it. Usually the endoclinch is the best one to hold this one. Okay. Now the esophagus is affected by the umbilical tape. I'm just widening the wrap, the window. This is umbilical tape, widening the window to make a loose wrap. And you have to make it just very, this is the two crura, one limb and the other limb. This will repair this one by the silk suture. Okay, this is, I'm using what's called endo stitch. It's very easy for the beginner to do stitch. Okay, and this is the silk 20 silk closing the crura. We are here closing the crura behind the esophagus. Again, the anterior wall of the esophagus, we never touch it. Nobody's dissecting anymore this esophagus. Okay, this is a stitch. I'm not going through it because it's just this. Okay, this one stitch. Sometimes take one or two stitch. Okay, once you raise the crura, but don't make it tight. Don't forget putting a big nasogastric bougie in the esophagus. Okay. So the core is repaired. Now we'll go for the funduplication. You will go by the Maryland from the left to the right to get the second stitch in the core. Okay, we'll take this one out. Okay, now we have to make the wrap behind the stomach. You have to take the fundus behind the esophagus, to make the full wrap. Okay, so this is the one. Okay, so you have to pass it behind the esophagus. But you have to be seen both limb where you see this is the wrap. Now it's coming behind the esophagus. So this is the fundus. It has to be a clear, loose wrap. Okay, so this is the medial limb, which is, has to come a good amount and very loose, very easy, because you have a wide window. Okay. Then you will take this probe and you will just my first stitch is the stomach, diaphragm, esophagus, anteromedial, and the stomach again. Okay, and again using endo stitch. Okay, this is the stomach. Then we'll give her a very good, only first stitch, a very good bite inside the diaphragm. This is the diaphragm done. Then we'll go for a small amount of esophagus, small amount. What happened? Okay, then you will take another two stitch after it. So the first one is the stomach, diaphragm, esophagus, stomach, then stomach. So it's three stitch. Okay, go for the second one. It's much easier. Okay, this is the second stitch. This is the second stitch. I need to explain something. Is the third stitch. Okay, this is the third stitch. When you are tying the stitch, don't tie it very strong because you make necrosis of the stomach. So if you make it tight, you have to loosen it because you don't like to have a gastric perforation. Because I did open one of my patients. See, the one who did the stitch, he did it very strong. And you can see the indentation inside the stomach. So you see, this is not nice. So you have to lose this stitch because you don't like to have a necrosis in the stomach. So you have to be sure that we are doing approximation and not strangulating the stomach. Okay, so this is the three stitch. This is the three stitch of the fundus. Then we'll go for what's called, there's a special setting to do what's called a gastrostomy. There is a special set to do gastrostomy, laparoscopic gastrostomy, which I don't have actually. So what we're doing in a simple way, so because you don't have a lot of luxury, it's called lab-assisted gastrostomy. What is lab-assisted gastrostomy? At the side of At the side of the gastrostomy, you see, you put at this side a 10 millimeter port, and get the stomach out to the abdomen to call lab assisted. You do a classic gastrostomy, stem gastrostomy, with the two breast strain, fixation to abdominal wall, lab assisted, all outside. And it's actually a 10 millimeter is more than enough. And you, after you do the gastrostomy, close the muscle around it and close the skin. It works very well and is very simple and very cheap. You can use Mellicot, you can use Mickey Bot, you can use anything. It's a very cheap one. Just will take the stomach out and bore out. And once it's everything out, you will do outside lab assist. This is a measurement. You don't like to get the gastrostomy near the pylorus because the balloon will obstruct the pylorus. And you don't like to pull it and affect the your fundal location, make it under tension. So you have to be very wise when you're taking. And this is a good size stomach. It's very easy. So the gastrostomy is done. Don't forget, even after in deflation of the abdomen, it will be much better. So once you would get the stomach outside, do a classic open gastrostomy, double breast sting, fix the abdominal wall, and put the tube in. Okay? Just you take everything, including the board. You take everything out. Okay? After, sorry, I don't have video because it's outside. It's not the stomach. But if you go here, you will see this is a gastrostomy, lab-assisted gastrostomy, very perfect. You don't need any of these. But you have also to review. After you did gastrostomy, you have to go and check your fundo affecting by gastrostomy or not. It looks like a perfect, no tension on the stomach, and the fundus looks very perfect with three stitch. Okay, and you do a fundo, you're not supposed to see any part of the diaphragm. The wrap has to be closely around the esophagus, because the diaphragm and the very good gastrostomy, you do some suction and that's it. Post-operative care, I'm giving antibiotic for 48 hours or more, depending on the patient. It has usually cerebral palsy patient admitted to ICU with repeated aspiration pneumonia. So you will speak with ICU patient doctors that once he's clear from pneumonia, you do the fundoplication before sending him home because you don't like him to come again and again for aspiration pneumonia. So in general, if the normal normal fundo, I will do antibiotic only for 48 hours. And the patient is a normal baby. Example, if I'm doing fundo for esophagitis or stricture, post top, or this type of normal brain, normal kids, they can go home in the next morning. But in our culture, it usually takes 2 or 3 days. The people with gastrostomy take more because you have to teach the mother how to deal with the gastrostomy. I'm usually statically for after 8 hours. You can use gastrostomy for medication, especially anticonvulsants, immediately after surgery, same time. Okay, they can go up for the food. If the patient is normal, he can eat anything. The only thing he's not allowed to do it to drink it is the fizzy drink because it makes bloating the stomach and the patient cannot burp. He cannot get the air out because of the fundo. So they are not allowed to take any fizzy drink. Okay, after that, I prefer my way. It's not a classic way you can use it, but I prefer very safe, especially neurological patient to do it feeding by gravity. Just put the gastrostomy tube in a big syringe and put the feed in the syringe. If the food is running through the syringe, that means is draining in very well, especially in the first 24 hours. So you will not give a bulk because the stomach is a little bit smaller than normal volume. So if before surgery was taken, for example, 200, you start by 100 and make it more frequent until the stomach be back to normal volume. Usually I'm seeing them in 1 or 2 weeks in the clinic. It depends on where they are living. Then 3, 6, and 12 months. Most of us, not all, we do upper GI study for what's called rab migration. Okay, most of complications, general sepsis, fever, wound infection, hematoma, this is like any general. A specific migration of the rab is more common, is the most common cause for redo, especially after laparoscopy, with or without obstructive symptoms. Sometimes the rab is migrate like the stomach, like our glass stomach, to obstruct the stomach. Disruption of the rab is more common with open and the recurrence one. Dysphagia, fundoplication can end by dysphagia, is if your rab is tight, it will end, we need dilatation post fundo. Or they have a different use for kind of his original cause of stricture. As I said, difficult to burp or plunging. He cannot get his air out. A gastric perforation from the tight suture. I saw it twice in my life, so we have to take care when you tie the suture on the rab. This is a rab migration. You have to understand some aspects. First, this is the rab, so we have to understand use the rab. And this is the rab. The rab is above prem. That means your fundo get above the rab. So This one without obstructive symptoms. This one with obstructive, it's like our glass of stomach. So the one with obstruction is passing, but is not passing normally because this is this only big contrast. Is this like a water? If the food a little bit sticking, it will be accumulated, it won't pass. So the way to treat these people is if you can, if the rub is good, take all the rub down under the crura, under Berza crura, which is more or less difficult, but you can still do it, or you will not find anything. You have to do a full redo, a fundoblockage. Okay. If you have a fundoblockage, you did redo fundoblockage, didn't work, redo fundoblockage, didn't work for the third time, it's called disconnection. Usually disconnection, do for me, 30 years plus of surgery, I did it twice in all my life. It's called, because the patient, you cannot control his reflux and his cerebral palsy aspiration, he's more or less ICU patient. So we will disconnect the esophagus from the stomach and you will do raw in y, esophagogenostomy and y. And this type of gastrostomy is called tube gastrostomy. You can do stem because the stomach, it won't reach outside. Was stem gastrostomy. Okay, it's not a common procedure, but it will stop reflux to the stomach, to the esophagus. Okay, this paper, like if you want to read it, is a red line for 2018. I think it's a very good paper. You can get it available in the net. No need to pay money or anything. Okay, thank you. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Hanan, for the enjoyable and concise presentation. And thank you for the video also. It was a very beautiful surgery, mashallah. We read some question and we try to answer all of it, inshallah. The first question, if the neonate is diagnosed as a 75 syndrome, what is the immediate management and what is the definitive treatment?
No, it depends. If it's only this syndrome, you will give him a medical management. But if it's the only indication, absolute indication to do fundo in a newborn is apneic spell. Apneic spell is a life-threatening condition. You understand the baby will have cyanosis and apnea, definite apnea, not only cyanosis with the feet. The syndrome, you can give him a seeking food and the medication, but if the medication is failed, you'll go for fundo.
Okay. The other question, did you do fundo for all the neurological patients with the GT, even if they are asymptomatic?
No. There's no, how you, why I would touch asymptomatic patient? The usually the neurological, some neurological patients, they are actually good without the, they're not 100% neurological patients. Okay, some of them, they are really good. Okay, some of them, they are taking oral feeds, even with bad cerebral palsy. It depends. We are not treating asymptomatic patients. We are treating only symptomatic. Okay. So how you will know is a patient is symptomatic, he has a reflux. Why he will come to you?
I think if the patient is going for the gastrostomy tube and he's a neurological patient,
you will do fundo.
You will do the fundo.
Yes, because as I said before, the gastrostomy can make a reflux. And usually this patient is very fragile, guys. He would. And the other point is you have to understand, especially in our culture, the mother have a couple of kids. And if to give the gastro, to make it, you can give the mother the choice. Give a what only gastrostomy. Usually it happens more in Europe, not in our side, guys. Okay, because I will give more gastrostomy. He may develop reflux. So you have to keep an eye. So she has to watch the child after each feed for at least 6 to 8 weeks. Okay. And he can die for one of them if you give him a large amount of feed. So in general, for me, I have a very low threshold for fundo application with gastrostomy for neurological.
How is the practical? How practical is the 24-hour pH monitoring? And it can't be done in the neonate age?
I was doing this, I don't know how to explain it. There's no evidence base about this. The other point is then the pH in newborn is 6. The stomach pH is 6, guys. It's not acidic. It's not really acidic. I don't know if you know this information. So to get a reflux in newborn by pH is very difficult. Do you understand what I mean? We are considering reflux by pH less than 4. The normal pH of the infant is the baby, newborn. It won't reach 4. This number. Number two is the sensitivity. There is no evidence based that the pH, not MII. It's good to confirm the reflux, but you cannot rule out reflux by pH. You understand this statement?
Yes.
Okay.
What is the standard test to diagnose the gastroesophageal reflux disease?
Standard. It's a very good question, actually, because if you read this paper, there's no sufficient evidence for all investigation. Okay, I would say I will take a proper history. I will do average eye study because it will give you a very good anatomical, very good anatomy to see it by your eyes. Again, for me and all my trainees, if you do any fluoroscopy, you have to attend. because it will give you a different picture to see when the gastric emptying happened, where is the DJ, gastroesophageal clearance, anatomy, where is the stomach, relation of the stomach with the position to the costal margin. There's a lot of points you have to attend. But I will go for the 4-hour GI study. I will go for endoscopy, but for neurological patients, I will go for history. If the patient is repeated admission for an ICU or hospital with aspiration pneumonia, I will do fondo. If you go to this paper they give you at the end 2018, if you take each investigation alone, it's not enough evidence, but you have to take it all around. So the BH monitor, especially MRI, is not available in our site. It's just too sophisticated and we don't have it. So it just, I mentioned because you have to know for the exam. Okay, but the BH, I'll go for upper GI study with the BH plus or minus endoscopy. Wow. And it's not actually, it's not one decision, guys. It's not a surgeon, it's a team. So you have the team between your nurse, the nurse looking, usually GI nurse, gastroenterologist and the surgeon. It's not only one. But the good gastroenterologist will say, no, go any neurological patient, even without over the phone, said, no, I'm not doing scope, just go for fun.
Okay, it's clear. The other question, in a neurological impairment child, following failed fundoplication for the second time, and do you attempt for esophagogastric disconnection or you will go for the redo for the third time?
It depends on the case. If the patient has severe scoliosis and he's okay, you can DNR his patient, this kid. Yeah, this need go practical, okay? Or you have to fix him. Surgery do, if you do secondary do, you will hate yourself. What about surgery do? If the secondary do didn't work, even with mesh, some people do mesh surgery. Surgery is absorbable mesh, guys. Putting on the core, at the back of the core, to raise the core. When you're closing the core at the back of the esophagus, you put a small mesh over it, called Sergi cyst. This is absorbable mesh, collagen mesh, okay? Just to reinforce that, but with a severe scoliosis, nobody can fix it. So as to do this, you can try for a certain time. I didn't try for a certain time, redo fund. But again, I did it twice in all my life. So this is a very rare surgery. And you do because the family pushing you to do it. Do you understand what this? No, I will not leave my child. You have to do something. So you have to disconnect. But for the redo second one, you have to be very cautious because redo second usually 18 to 20% you need another third surgery. Second redo surgery, 18 to 20% of them they will not need another procedure. Is that clear? Again, if you do fundoplication didn't work, it depends. You can go for the third redo, which is unlikely, or you can go for disconnection. But again, it's individual decision. You cannot take decision for all patients. You can say, I will do this way. Each case has its own decision.
Okay, we move to the next question.
You didn't get the, I think you didn't get this clear. Again, I would say, you do fundo, you do the second time, you may do for the third time. Third time fundo, or disconnection depends on the case of the patient itself, condition of the patient itself. And the one he did the secondary do fundo, he's the only one knows what is the anatomy inside. Okay.
Yes.
If you have a weak diaphragm, we reinforce. If the anatomy is disaster, disconnect.
Okay, it's clear now. If you are doing laparoscopic fundoplication while you are dissecting the crura, you injured the pleura. Did you insert chest tube or you only observed?
It happened with me. Don't worry. Put a chest tube. Don't worry. It happened with me. It was one of my training. But this is what I'm saying. If you have to direct it laterally. If you go upward, you will go inside the pleura. And we saw the lung plane. Guys, surgery, if you cannot deal with the complication, you cannot do surgery. You understand this method? Anything can happen. You can fix it in a safe way, do it. The people that do training a lot, you will have face a lot of problem with it. By the end of the day, it's our responsibility, it's the responsibility of the consultant, but it can happen. And it happened in a second, guys. So don't worry, because we are doing laparoscopy, the air is too much in. If the patient puts the pressure, nothing will happen, but by the end of the surgery, you will put a small, big tail chest drain underwater, say for 24 hours. No need to put a chest drain, do you understand? Just use a small, big tail for the air. You know the big tail for nephrostomy, the small one.
Yes, yes.
You can build a small one. It's more than enough.
Okay. In a severely neurological impaired child with a multiple comorbidity, and he's a DNR patient, and he developed a gastroesophageal reflux, severe type, and he also had multiple aspiration pneumonia, did you attempt to do a fundoplication, or you just...
Yes. Okay, guys, you have to understand, I'm doing fund duplication for the neurological patient, not to cure him, to give the family better nursing capacity. You know what nursing? Nursing capacity. The patient, the mother can deal with him without danger. A better quality of life for the family more than the child himself. So the mother can give the feeding by pump and she should not be scared from aspiration. You understand, the mother can give me a volume of a bolus feeding without fear of aspiration. The fund duplication for a severe neurological patient is make the nursing for him is much easier. Okay, so you are not curing.
Even if he had the multiple comorbidities with it, and he's in our
own. Okay, what you will do, DNR, either to send him to die at home, or DNR is just will not put him on for ventilation. If he's aspirated and coming with aspiration, don't ventilate him. You understand this? But if he survives, what he will do?
Yes, I got your point.
Guys, we are not a killer. We are not, we're giving better quality for our patient as much as we can. We are not the God, subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, but you have to go look for this mother. She has 6 kids at home and nobody can help her. And usually even if she has a maid at home, the only one look after a neurological child is the mother herself. So give her at least a couple of hours to sleep safely. You have to look for all family guys. Don't look for his comorbidities. I'll DNR him, but if he survives the pneumonia, what he will do? You have to fix him.
Yeah,
it's a point of controversy, guys. But for me, I will fix him, send him home safe to his mother. And if he dies or something else, it's not me. But you are not cure the patient. I'm not treating a curable disease. I'm just helping the family, helping himself to have a normal life with normal food without complication. Hisham, you are doing fund duplication to feed the baby, the child properly.
Yes.
Not to cure him.
Yeah, not to cure him. Yes, I got your point. Is the fixation of the RAP to anterior abdominal wall will prevent the RAP migration? And did you do it?
The best way to prevent the RAP migration is a proper repair of the colon. I have a video, I can send it to you. I can send a couple of videos with proper. This video without montage at all, so you have to see every mistake in it. But if you didn't repair the core, the RAP, even whatever the RAP you are doing, good or bad, it will go up. So this why is a couple of 10 years ago, you have to dissect the esophagus to make intra-abdominal esophageal longer, which is all fake. All nobody's doing this. Okay, so the only point is don't dissect the anterior esophagus. And I am fixing the first stitch to the frag, not to avoid migration, just to fix my RAP, because I don't like to go down to make that sort of hourglass stomach. You understand? Sometimes RAPs go down, go to the stomach itself. So I'm fixing only the first stitch to the frag to avoid the RAP to be fixed to the frag, not to avoid the RAP to go above them. You understand?
Okay, so you always fix it to the diaphragm.
Yes, but not this small stitch. It will not prevent the RAP if the crura is loose to go up. I'm fixing the diaphragm because the RAP is just a ring. It can go down to the stomach. And I saw it makes the stomach hourglass. You understand this point, guys? I will go for my slide, please. It's from me, I'm right? Okay, go for my slide.
You can share your slide.
Okay, this one. Okay, you see, sometimes imagine this is all under their frag. So my DRF, it will go in the middle of the stomach. It make gastric obstruction, like hourglass inside the abdomen. If the RAP moved down, it's like a ring. The stomach is a loose RAP, it's like a ring. It go up and down. Did you get this point? Guys, if you cannot understand, let me know. The RAP is that like a ring around the stomach, around the esophagus, right or wrong? When you make it, yes, esophageal right. RAP, it's a ring around the lower esophagus. Okay? I saw it twice in my life that the RAP, it went down in the middle of the stomach. So the patient was refluxing because it would not fix it. And it has a sort of hourglass stomach inside the abdomen. Is that clear or not? No, it's not. Am I right, Hisham?
For me, I didn't get it.
Okay, again. What is RAP? You are making a sort of a ring of the stomach around the lower esophagus.
Yes.
Okay? Yeah. So this is RAP. If the RAP is loose, what will happen? Part of the stomach will forget the chest. Part of the stomach, we are repairing the core very good. But part of the stomach will go above the RAP. What will happen? Like a ring. It will go up and down.
Yes.
I need everyone to get this point, guys. It does. If you make a loose RAP and did not fix it to the diaphragm with a small stitch, it can go down like a migrating. But instead of the chest, it go down to the stomach. Make it hourglass stomach. It will not go to the middle of the stomach. Yes. It will go a little bit down. Is that clear now?
It's clear. No, yeah, it's clear.
Are you sure?
Yes. Sure, okay. It's clear.
Okay.
We have a lot of questions. I will try to answer it all. Okay. Will post-esophageal atresia repair, when you will consider front duplication?
The same like any reflux. First, post-esophageal repair, usually they have a stricture. A stricture makes the reflux, reflux makes the stricture worse and it goes to the vicious cerc. So I will dilate with balloon, but usually balloon initially at least initially. I prefer balloon in general, but initially I will go by balloon. I make the dilatation every 2 weeks, then 3 weeks, then I'll go for fun. If the flux is significant, is that clear?
Yeah.
If clear. The patient has a, is unlikely to have a reflux for tough without stricture.
What is the other type of fund duplication except the nascent fund duplication?
Okay, there's a thal fund duplication, anterior wrap. Okay, in the history, we're saying is if you do gastroesophageal motility, which is usually in adults, you would say full wrap if the esophagus have a good motility, three-quarter wrap, which is to bay, posterior one, or cell anterior one. Cell is 180 degree and only covering the anterior part is useless. All this is useless. This has to be full wrap, full loose wrap for anisin one. The cell is done only in post-hilar myotomy, just to protect the raw area of the mucosal or esophageal mucosa. This is only, it won't prevent reflux.
Okay, we'll move to the other question. All,
even the paper sent it, or even in base now, all of us doing anisin fund, or full wrap, forget the name, full wrap, 360 wrap.
Okay, we'll move to the other question. What is the timeline and role of trial of medical management, and how young can you perform the fund application?
So medical management, if after 8 weeks, I would consider surgery, but it depends on the age of the patient. You will not treat infant as a child. Infant usually be a little bit, if there's no apneic spread, no nothing is dangerous, will be more patient within more. In the healthy one, not neurological one. Neurological will go for fundus. So this is the big neurological fundus. So we'll take off the neurological patient. Infant will be more patient with seeking food with medical treatment. But if the child is bigger and you start to have a chest pain or complain, you will do endoscopy. If any change, you will do fundus. Again, neurological patient, all fundus. For babies, I'll be more patient because my age will be better. Okay, for the children, if they become symptomatic, complaining, for medical treatment. If failed or bad compliance, it actually is more, most of them is bad compliance, you will go for surgery.
Okay.
Average number 28. Some people wait till 6 months, by the way. Again, Hasham, is not a surgery decision, is multidisciplinary team.
It's a multidisciplinary team. Yes.
Gastroenterology has to be involved in each step. It's not just he will do fundo and that's it. No.
Yes, of course. So I think we still have a time. We have 10 minutes more.
Okay.
We'll continue with the question. When we decide to do fund duplication in a patient post-tracheostomy fistula repair with a recurrent gastroesophageal reflux with developing stricture?
You just say, okay, you will do dilatation because you don't like to dilate the baby. If you're using balloon, you can do fundo at any time because balloon is want to go in. But if you will go for Stafari dilator or any Bouguer dilator, you have to go for dilatation, two to three sessions, then go for fundo. You can do both in same session if you are doing balloon because balloon, it want to go inside the cardia. It will go only to the stricture. Is that clear? If you wave dilatation like Bouguer or Safari dilator, that means it will go through the cardia, do dilatation couple of times before fundo. If you are using balloon for tough, you can do both in the same setting. And you can do even dilatation both fundo by the balloon. Clear or not?
Yes, it's clear.
No, clear because Bouguer or Safari will go through the cardia. So if you have a fundo, it will disrupt your fundo. If the patient, the people, they don't have a balloon dilator, they have to go for dilatation couple of sessions before fundo. They have to do this. And if you have a stricture because of the reflux, you will do dilatation before fundo. Or you will use a balloon, but don't go with the balloon through the cardia.
Can we do it on the same setting?
Balloon, yes.
The dilatation.
Guys, you have to understand, balloon dilatation is only dilates the stricture area because you can see the length of the balloon, 2 centimeters, 4 centimeters. You can stretch even for the stricture refluxing or caustic, you can choose the length of the balloon. For the dilator like Safari, okay, it will go through the cardia. So you cannot do dilatation and the fundus in the same setting with the cephalic. If the patient needs more than one session, if the patient needs one session only, which is very unlikely, you can do the same session. But usually the patient will need more than one session. If you have a balloon, do both in the same setting. If you need more dilatation, you can do it with balloon. If you don't have a balloon dilatation, using cephalic dilator or bougie dilator, please do a couple of session dilatations in fundus. Clear or not?
Yes, clear.
Okay.
What is the landmark for opening the window behind the esophagus?
As much as wide or what? Landmark, your left
gastric. Landmark,
left gastric below, above the left gastric. And you saw in the video, when we did it below the left gastric, we get the artery down and make the window above it. So your landmark is the left gastric. You go open the peritoneum. Usually find the caudate lobe in your area just retracted. You will not see it for laparoscopy, see it only for open. Okay, once you open the peritoneum in the medial aspect of the esophagus, you will feel the tube with the Maryland, the nasogastric or the bougie, you will feel it. You go under it and make the window. When you make the window, make it transverse from right to left, not from right up. And below the level, above the level of the left gastric. And by the way, I'm not short gastric, guys. In the book, you have to take down the short gastric. For me, I'm not taking it down. You understand this or not? There's a lot of people taking off the short gastric in the left side with the spleen to do the fundus. Hello, Hisham?
Hello, yes, Dr. Hanan.
Can you hear me? One of the steps of the fundus lubrication, you have to take down or to cut the short gastric to make the full wrap.
Full wrap, yes.
Okay. For me, I'm not taking the short gastric down and I don't have problem with the wrap. But in the exam, you will say, I will take the short gastric down.
Okay. Yeah, I got you. What you mean?
Yes.
The other question, PPI not effective in neonate, in which age specifically? No,
I'm not saying there's no evidence basis effective. But the people abusing it. There's overuse of the proton pump inhibitor in newborn and the infant. But according to evidence base, you don't have its effect is effective or not. And you don't have a clear idea about this complication of it. So we don't know. The answer is we don't know. Okay. I'm speaking about evidence base, Hisham. Literature. This is what I'm about. The last study of 2018 is wonderful. It's getting each item separate.
Okay. The Barrett esophagus is irreversible. Are we doing fundus lubrication to prevent the further complication or for quality of life?
No, Barrett esophagus, you can make it reversible or stop progressive if you treat it early and do the fundus. Usually once you start, you will do the fundus.
Yes, I'm with you.
So Barrett esophagus, if you do very early, you start metaplasia, it is reversible. But if it is metaplasia for a larger area or established metaplasia, it won't be reversible. It's when the stage you are doing. It's why if you have a patient with Barrett esophagus, you will do cervicals, you will do a biopsy. It depends on the stage again. The gastroenterologist will say, I'll do scope every 6 months or every year or every 2 years. So even if you do fundus, you have to follow up this patient. Some of them, they were reversed in the early stage. In late stage, no. They will enter follow up rest of the life for malignancy.
Okay. I think we have a lot of questions and we're running out of the time. Dr. Hanan, thank you so much for being with us. And we're very happy that you were with us. And inshallah, we'll see you soon and we'll hear your voice again and again. Thank you so much, Dr. Hanan, for joining us.
Okay, Habib. Shukran, Ibo. Thank you for everyone, and I hope to see you, meet you
again. Inshallah, Sonia Rabbi. Atik al-afiyah, Dr. Hanan. For all the attendees, thank you so much for the attendance, and thank you for your support, and we will be so happy to see you again and again. If there is any suggestion, you can post it on Twitter, or you can send it to our email.